Amen. We just want to welcome everybody to our God's Anointed Now Generation service. I know we've been having World Conference, and we weren't able to get together. But hey, we're back. Come on now, we're back. World Conference was powerful. We pray and we hope that you enjoyed it and that you received the word, because I know that we did. But once again, we just want to welcome you out to our Victory Outreach Barstow Gang Night. Come on now, if you're a newcomer, we want to encourage you to put your name. And on the Facebook comment, share, you can actually see our information where you can contact us. And we would love to exchange information and just get to know each other, get you plugged into the church. But right now, what we want to do is maybe give it another minute or so to share it. If you're on YouTube, share it. If you're on Facebook, go ahead and get all those loved ones, all your friends, maybe that you haven't talked to in a while. You want to send it to them, send the link. Help us to get the word of God out there. I know we have Jonathan tuned in on our YouTube. I know we have Alavina tuned in on our Facebook. But any further ado, let's open up with a word of prayer. And we know that God wants to move tonight. And we're excited. And it's a blessing to be here. With that being said, let's open up with a word of prayer. And let's get gang night popping. Amen. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, God. And I just pray, Lord, that you remove distractions inside of our home, that you will give us a full focus, that we'll give you our full attention tonight, my God, that you will speak, that you will move freely, my God, with the worship and everything, with the sermon, Lord. I place tonight into your hands, and we know that you have something special, God. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen, gang. Are you guys excited to be able to worship God tonight? How many of you came expecting a move of God? Are you come in need of God in your life? If that's you, I challenge you, stand up right there in your home and just lift your hands. Lift your hands as a sign of surrenderance to Him and just begin to worship Him. Jesus, we worship you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, we love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. Water you turned into wine. You open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. There's none like you, Jesus. Into the darkness you shine. Oh, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Oh, there's no one like you, Lord. There's none like you. Oh, come on, sing. Our God is greater. Oh, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any. God is healer, awesome in power, our God, oh, water you turn into wine, you open the eyes of the blind, there's no one. There's none like you. Oh, sing it with all your heart. He's greater. Oh, our God is greater.
Worship Him. Fall in love with His presence. Release yourself to Him. Surrender to Him. Drop down to your knees and praise Him. Don't be ashamed. Praise Him. Praise Him. Hallelujah. We love you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, have your way. Take full control, Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. What's up, gang? Is God's anointing now generation in the house or what? Come on now. So right now, I wanna remind you guys, you know, with some reminders right here. You know, I want to let you know right now where you're at. That tomorrow, we have our original in San Bernardino. Come on now. The England Empire, Coachella Valley, and the High Desert at 7 p.m. online. You do not want to miss out. Make sure you tune in. And also, Gang Warriors, where you at? Remember, on Tuesday at 7 p.m., we have United Life Group this week. And don't forget our midweek service at 7. And Sunday morning at 10 a.m. And then also, I want to say, don't forget our Friday nights, every Friday night at 7 at 7 p.m. And also, I want to let you guys know that if you're a gang, if you're with it, follow us on Instagram. You know, VO_gang. You know, we got raps, spoken words, and specials coming soon. And right now, I want to introduce the High School Impact, you know, with the special. So I want to call up Brother Ozzy. Thank you.
Amen, amen. What's up, gang? You guys ready? I know this will be a powerful night here tonight for those viewing. Amen. We want to welcome you, all those on Facebook, all those on YouTube. And continue to share. Continue to invite, you know, your friends, your loved ones. I know we have brothers and sisters. I know we have friends from work, from school. Come on. But here tonight, I'm here representing the high school impact. And I want to encourage some high schoolers. I want to say, where you at, high school? Come on now. I want you to shout out if you're in high school, and I want you to tune in on the chat. But also, I want you to be encouraged here tonight. Before I go into this spoken word, I just want to encourage you. I know many of you have gifts. Many of you have talents. And it talks about people with some talents that, you know, Jesus points them out. It talks about people having a little talent than more than the other, right? And then it talks about the one that buried it. But what happened to that one that buried their talent? Jesus called them slothful. Jesus called them lazy. Jesus said, hey, man, you know, he's called us for so much more. And I believe many of you can tap into that gift that you have. You have a desire to learn how to do something. Believe that you can do it. Believe that Jesus will anoint you, that God will anoint you. We're God's anointed now generation. You see, when you tap into his anointing, he'll place it upon you and he'll allow you to access, amen, that gift to play an instrument, that gift to sing, that gift to jump into any type of skill that you might have or desire to have. But you got to work at it. And you got to believe that God will help you through it. So on behalf of my brother Edgar and the team, I just want to go ahead and just go for it here tonight. And it reads, In a society where there is a standard set higher than anyone can see or could imagine to be, it's a sad reality that everyone wants to pursue the lifestyle promising purpose. But behind the curtains, the choice isn't up to you. It's the ugly beautiful who refuse you. The ones you want as your friends. Their beauty draws you in, but the ugly inside is ready to take your life. They tell you how to live, how to be, how to speak, and even how to breathe. Breathe in the toxic, they say. All the pain inside will go away. They bury the ugly deep inside, and they portray to be the way to life. You can call them the popular, those of you in school. You can call them the stars in the screens of your phones and TV. You can call them the idols you wish to be. But I tell you now, looks are deceiving. They say, look like me, speak like me, you'll have everything I have. They say, be like me, but they don't tell you what they've done or who they were and who they become. Once a little girl or a boy like you, just dreaming, but compromising their morals and their convictions for a feeling is what they've been taught. So they sit back in their glamour, further from their true purpose they were called to live. And they're not alone. They got you in the mix if your choice is to live for their fix. I can tell you, it's not promising. It's a contest nobody wins. A life you'll find yourself all alone in, crying inside because you never belonged to them. And you finally realize you'll never look like them, talk like them, or be them. You have a heart for purpose, but hearts belong in the light, not in the darkness. You belong to the ones who love you, but there's one who truly knows you. He doesn't put you aside when you don't satisfy their eyes. He loves you more than you know or you'll ever recognize. He has passion for you to live your full potential in life, so much so that he would even choose to die to endure a pain he didn't deserve, but you, for you to be alive was his desire. So he took the nails and the whips to give you a true purpose and to wash the ugly within. He calls you beautiful in and out. His love is not the world's love. It doesn't fit like a glove. There's no limit to his love for you. His love is more than enough. He's drawing you away from the place they call purpose. It's imitation and its picture perfect image never lasts. It's like a flight trap drawing you in to be stuck. Just another one of them hanged up and waiting to die. Jesus said, I got the abundant life and the everlasting paradise. Purpose in him is forever and ever. Never let this road tell you it can never be. Jesus already said it, so don't wait no more. Just believe. Amen. God bless you. Call up my brother J.O. Amen.
What up, gang? I have a privilege to do tithes and offerings right now. And right now, I'm tripping out because me and being in the world, I never did tithes and offerings. Like, I always went to church and I always be like, man, you know what? They just want the money, you know? So I was never putting anything in the baskets, you know? But now that I came to Victory Outreach, you know, I understand what's the purpose behind it and why. And it says it in the Bible in Deuteronomy 14:22, the word of God says, you must set aside a tithe of your crops. 1/10 of all the crops you harvest each year. So right there, it tells you straight out right there what you need to do with your tithes and offerings. Put 10% aside. You know, so every dollar, you know, if you have a dollar, it's 10 cents. You know, just trust them. Trust them and try it out, and best believe you will be blessed. You know, there's a blessing behind it. There's a miracle behind it. You want to see your family healed, changed, and it starts with your tithes and offerings. So with that, I want to pray for the tithes and offerings. Amen. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, Father. I pray, Father God, you bless those who can't and bless those that do, Father. In the name of Jesus, Father God, have your way, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. How many of you guys are excited to be tuned in to our Friday night gang night? I just want to encourage everybody, go ahead and drop a comment, share the page, like the page. And I know that God wants to move tonight. Amen. So like I said, just share it, like it, drop a comment, a prayer request. But before we even start with the message, what we want to do is we just want to worship God. Amen. Worship God because of who he is and what he's done. Because honestly, I feel like, hey, God deserves it. God deserves our glory. So maybe if you find yourself at home sitting down, or maybe you can find yourself right here in the church sitting down, I want to encourage you to stand up and worship God. Come on out, just stand up and worship Jesus. Right there, wherever you may be at. Your healer, if you know God's your king, if you know what he did for you on that cross, I want to encourage you to let it out, to unlock your praise, to let the neighbors hear your voice tonight. Maybe you're in the car, or maybe wherever you may find yourself tuning in, I encourage you, I challenge you to let it out.
Then what could stand against
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for who you are. We want to thank you tonight, God, because you're our King. You're our Savior. We wouldn't be here tonight if it wasn't for you, God. And we just want to worship you, Lord. We just want to praise your name because you deserve it, God. But I place tonight into your hands, God. I place this message, Lord. If maybe there's distractions inside of the homes when they're tuning in, I pray, God, that you will give them a focus, a freedom, Lord. That your spirit will be felt inside of the homes, God. That your spirit will be felt wherever they may be tuning in. That you'll be pushing back darkness, God. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I just thank you, God. In the name of Jesus, Lord. In the name of Jesus, God. Amen. Amen. Right there in your home, on YouTube or on Facebook, drop a comment. Come on, somebody, just drop a comment. Like the page. But once again, we just want to welcome you out to our gang night. And we're believing, we know. I got to change my vocabulary from believing to knowing, having the confidence in him, you know, that God's going to do something special. Amen. Thank God for the worship team. Powerful. Amen. But once again, we just want to welcome you out. And we know that God has something special. And tonight's message, what I want to focus on is unlocking your praise. Amen. Unlocking your praise. The title of the message is going to be called Unlock Your Praise. Amen. We just want to welcome everybody out. But before we even start with the message, what I want to do is I just want to thank God for my salvation. You know, because he's good. He's great. I'm thankful. I'm thankful that I'm able to serve him. I'm thankful that I have a purpose in my life now. You know, I'm thankful that I'm not on drugs no more. I'm thankful because I'm able to see my mom plug into the Victory Outreach Church as well. And I'm thankful for so many different things. I also want to thank God, you know, for our founders, Pastor Sonny and Sister Julie, because their faithfulness and their obedience to the voice of God. I also want to say that I'm grateful for my pastor, Pastor Abel and Sister Raina, the hard work and everything that they do and everything that's going on right now with this whole COVID thing. You know, you're able to see that the church is strengthened, and I'm grateful for that too. Amen. I also want to thank God for the gang team. If the gang team is here, you know, drop a comment on there. Amen. That being said, I'm going to do my best not to be long. But here it is. Amen. The title of the message is going to be called Unlock Your Praise. And I want to invite you to Acts chapter 16, verse 25. And when you guys get there, I'm going to open up with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, God, and I just pray, Lord, for a movement of your Holy Spirit. I ask right now that you will go into the homes, go into the hearts, into the minds right now, Lord, and that you will just completely move in a special way, in a way that this word would just be for them, specifically that person, God. I just pray that you will move, God, move with freedom, remove distractions. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. So in Acts chapter 16, I'm going to read it a little. I'm going to start in Acts chapter 16, verse 22. Amen. The crowd joined the attack against Paul and Silas, and they ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they had been thrown into prison, and the jailers were commanded to guard them carefully. When he had received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet with the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundation of the prison door, the prison was shaken. At once, all prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. The jailers woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword, was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." Amen. And tonight's message, I want to look at the scripture before we start getting into the message. I want to share that in this portion of scripture, you can find Paul and Silas, right? They're doing the work of the Lord. You know, they're casting out demons. It goes a little more up. We're just talking about there was a female slave, right, who was following them. And what they did is Paul and Silas, they cast out a demon, right? And when they cast out a demon, right, they got brought before the courts. And they didn't just get brought before the courts, they got beaten. And they didn't just get beaten, they got put in prison. You know, they got put in prison for doing the work of God. And the commentaries say that the courts, right, had the apostles' clothes torn off before they were punished, before punishment, right, as a custom before flogging them. Among the Jews, it was restricted to 40 lashes. And the stock was a piece, and if we're not too familiar with the stock was a piece of a wood that was containing holes, which the feet of the prisoners were fastening so that escape would be impossible. Amen. And then Paul and Silas were imprisoned into the deepest and the darkest cell within the jail. And they used this as an instrument for torment and confinement as well. If you're already able to see what type of treatment they're getting, because they were being some disciples, they were being some real deal gang warriors, you can say, some real deal gang members. Amen. But even in a dark and an ugly place, in a lonely place, right? I like this because even then, they seem to find a way how to pull worship out of them. Come on, now they found a way how to pull some worship out of them. And I know during this whole quarantine thing and during the season that we're in, it can sometimes feel like a prison. I don't know if some of you can agree, but I know sometimes it can feel like a prison to some. You know, and the thing is, when many were asleep, Paul and Silas were burning their midnight oil. Amen. And I know at times it can get a little hard to praise. I know at times it can be a little hard to pull some praise out of you, to pull that praise out of you. It can be a little difficult when you're going through battles, when you're going through your struggles, when you're going through some difficult times. It can be a little challenging. But hey, Paul and Silas, they did it, right? And tonight I want to focus on unlocking your praise. Because everything that they faced would have told them, hey, don't praise. Hey, don't worship. By them being thrown in prison, right? They're in a confinement place. And they were just waiting for sentencing, right? But hey, that didn't discourage them. As a matter of fact, I love it because they encouraged them. You know, they got beaten. And it wasn't just a normal beating that sometimes we used to get from our moms or our dads, right? Not a normal whipping from the belt like a couple of times. No, they got whooped. They got at least 40 lashes. They'll say up to 39. And also brought before the courts when the court was supposed to bring justice. Hey, they threw them in prison. And right, and I like to look at this, is what does it mean to unlock? You know, to lay open, to unlock the secrets of one's heart. I like that definition right there. I'm going to stick to that one. Amen. To undo the lock of, especially with the key, and maybe we can find ourselves in a prison cell, like I said, an ungodly environment, in the wrong crowd. You know, trying to fit in. So many different things that we can relate this prison cell to. But the secret to this, the secret and the key to that prison, it was their worship. It was their praise that they had inside of them. Amen. So what unlocked their praise? What unlocked the prison doors? It was their praise and their worship. But tonight I wanna look at it a little different, because I wanna get a little more in depth and bring out worship a little different, because sometimes we can get caught up and just think like, hey, worship is just a good song. Worship is just like, I'm going to raise my hands at the altar, and I'm going to say amen when it's time to say amen, and I'm going to jump, and I'm going to shout, and I know the whole Christian language, you know, the Christianese, right? I know all of that, but it was a little more to them. It was a little more, even in the midst of, even when it could have seemed like the world was against them, like the whole world, their whole world was crumbling. They had a daily devotion with God. Amen. They were trained correctly. And I love Paul because he knew how to start battles and win wars. And my first point I want to look at is, what is the key to unlock the prison door? Like I was sharing, it was their worship, right? But like I said, I want to bring it out a little different. It was a daily devotion. It's because they were set apart for something great. And I know some of you are tuning in tonight that, hey, God's setting you apart right now. Hey, it doesn't matter what you're going through right now. It doesn't matter if you find yourself in a prison cell. It doesn't matter if you find yourself around the wrong people. God's going to set you apart, and you're going to unlock not just your prison cell, but unlock many other cells as well. Right? Worship is being set apart for his service. And I like this because Paul and Silas, they were still having church. Come on now, that reminds me of Victory Outreach. They were still having church with this whole quarantine thing. Hey, we're still having church. We're still getting the word of God out there. As a matter of fact, what they did is they brought church to the prison. Come on now, they brought church to the prison. And if you look at it more, is the prison doors got open because of their worship, right? But if you look more into it, it all started before they even started singing, before they even started singing their hymns. Right? It was a lifestyle that they brought forward. It was a lifestyle that they were living. It was a daily devotion that created the impact that when they started lifting up their voice, when they started doing the war cry, when they started crying out to God, next thing you know, God showed up. And you know, when God shows up, he shows out. Amen? So I want to look at these, right? The four D's, and I know Pastor shared it, and I want to bring it out because I feel like the Spirit of God was just leading me to share this. The four D's, daily, you know, being consistent about your relationship with God. Come on now. A daily devotion will put an anointing on your spirit. When you're consistent about God, when you're tuning in to everything that we have, when you're tuning in to our morning prayer meetings, hey, God, what God's doing, he's training you. What God's doing, he's pouring an anointing on your spirit. Being consistent, being faithful to your daily relationship with God. Also, another one is discipline, where you're able to be disciplined when it comes to praying, when it comes to reading your word, when it comes to fasting, right? Where you're disciplined, where you're able to pull all distractions away, and really dig into God. Because I know at times our phone can be a distraction when we're in prayer. I know at times, you know, people around us can be a distraction when we're in our word. I know at times, right, all of a sudden your family members want to bring you some delicious food, right, some bomb food when you're fasting, right? We need to know how to be disciplined. The first one was daily, being consistent. The second one, discipline. And one thing about these spiritual disciplines is that I love is that God intended all these spiritual disciplines to be for normal people. Because sometimes we can look at people and we can be like, hey, that's pastor. Hey, that's the leadership. And hey, that's just them. Like, that's not for me. Like, no, all these disciplines are meant and God intended them for every single person that's tuning in, every single person that's here at the church. God created these disciplines specifically for you. And you don't need to be a spiritual giant. Amen. A person that has an ordinary job, right? that has a family, you know, that lives a normal life. These are the disciplines. As a matter of fact, these disciplines are best exercised with people that live a normal life. Amen. The third D is dependent. Fully relying on God for whatever you may need or whatever you may want. You're fully relying on God. You're depending on God. You're not depending on a check. Come on. You're not depending on unemployment. You're depending on God. You're saying, hey, look, God, I need you. Hey, God, I need you to show up in my prayer life. I need you to show up, you know, in my disciplines. I need you to show up in everything that I'm asking you for. Also, the fourth D is desperate. Is when you know you need him and you can't do it without him. When you're desperate. I'm not talking about a type of desperate where it's just for a moment. I'm talking about where you stay desperate for God. It doesn't matter how high in leadership you may get, where you're desperate for God, where you're in need of God, where every day you're saying, I need you, God, because I can't do this without you. Hey, I need you, God. Hey, as a matter of fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go a little longer in prayer because the battles seem a little more rougher. The battles seem a little more stronger. The strongholds are getting a little more enhanced for me. I know I can't do it by myself. I need you, Jesus, where you're staying desperate. And I like one thing about desperation, right? Because desperation will make room and make things happen. Desperation doesn't make excuses. Desperation, and I shared this parable before, where the lady that was bleeding, that had an issue of blood, right, for 12 years, but she was desperate. Hey, the voice of desperation told her to dig in there. The voice of desperation told her, hey, don't take no for an answer. I need you to go in there, and I need you to get a hold of God. Desperation made room for itself, and it made things happen. Amen. The second thing I want to bring out is about I want to look at the characteristics of Paul. Because we know being set apart and living a life that's set apart for God, right? It's a form of worship. And I want to look at Paul because, hey, Paul was a worship leader. Hey, he knew how to make things happen. He knew how to live a life that was set apart. He knew how to live that gang life. Amen. He knew how to live that church life. I want to look at Paul real quick because Paul was a great leader. You know, he gathered others to themselves, right, and worked with them. He didn't just work with them. He trained them. You know, he sent them out. He established churches. And he stayed in contact with every single one of them through letters. Also, another thing about Paul, a characteristic about him, is that he was wholehearted. He was all in. That was a good thing about him. He was all in. Because before, he wasn't all in for God. As a matter of fact, he was killing Christians, but he had an encounter with God. And what that happened is that turned him over to God. And he was all in. Come on, now he was all in. He gave all of his heart. He gave every single inch of his heart for the cause. To preach the good news, you know, to tell people about God, to tell people about Jesus. He focused all his energy in serving God. He was all in. And he was highly educated, but he got a lot done. And also another thing is that he knew how to endure. And I feel like like I said, I'm bringing our worship a little different, but I feel like, hey, these are all worshipers because they lived a life that was set apart. And not just that, these were the characteristics that were in them that you were able to see, the set-apart type of lifestyle. He knew how to endure. Paul faced continual oppositions, right? When he was fulfilling his goal, you know, that anytime he came around, they were stirring up riots, right? They were throwing him in prison. You know, they were forcing him from town to town. But Paul also faced many false teachers who spoke against his teaching and criticized him behind his back. Hey, Paul was a worshiper. Because even through all this that was going on, is he knew how to worship. Even through everything that he was facing, is he was like, hey, you know what? I don't care if they're talking behind my back because I got a purpose. I don't care if you kick me out of town. I don't care whatever you want to do is I'm going to get the word of God out there. No matter how darkness will love to come my way, I know I got a target on my back. Come on, I know I got some demons that are trying to knock me off. But guess what? I'm not going to stop. As a matter of fact, I'm going to go a little harder. As a matter of fact, I'm going to build up a team. I'm going to build some churches. I'm going to disciple some people. And I'm going to establish some. And hey, God used them to write Bible page, to write Bible pages. And one thing about Paul also was he gave all the glory to God. He gave all his glory. Paul never tried to get credit or glory for himself. Everything he did, he pointed it back to God. So we're looking at what is worship, right? Like bringing it out a little different. A lifestyle that's set apart. You know, the characteristics of, hey, Paul, because he was a worship leader. Hey, because he knew how to worship. The third point that I want to look at is, what is worship able to do? And as I call the worship team up, right? What is worship able to do? Worship is a weapon. Worship is a weapon. And I want to bring out Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 20. You are my war club, my weapon for battle. With you, I shatter nations. With you, I destroy kingdoms. Amen. When you're living a life that's set apart, when you're living a life that's daily, consistent, with your relationship with God, when you're disciplined spiritually, when you're depending on God, and not just depending on God, but you're desperate for God, it doesn't matter where you feel in life, how far you got, you know, you're always gonna live a life that's set apart. And when you do that, when you start singing, and when you start bringing out worship out of your mouth, things start happening. Amen. And that's what he was doing with Jeremiah. He was using him as a secret weapon, as a weapon for battle. With you, I shatter nations. With you, I destroy kingdoms. I know there's some worshipers that are tuning in, some people that are living a life that's set apart, some people that may be going through some battles and going through some struggles, but hey, they're living a life that's gonna praise. They're living a life that's going to be sold out for God. And I like this scripture, right, about David when he went against Goliath. David said to the Philistine, you come against me with the sword and the spear, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down, and I will cut off your head. Hey, maybe you've been going through that, right? Maybe you've been going through a season where you may feel like the enemy, the devil, the circumstance that you're in, the position that you may be facing right now, it may tell you, hey, I'm gonna throw you in a prison cell, and I'm gonna keep you silent. As a matter of fact, what I'm going to do is I'm not going to allow praise to come out of your mouth. I'm going to silence you because this problem is bigger than what you're able to do. But hey, David had a different type of spirit, because what did he do? He said, look, ain't no giant, ain't no prison cell, ain't nothing too big for my God, ain't nothing that's going to be able to stop my praise. As a matter of fact, what God's going to do is he's going to give me your head, and not just that, what he's going to also do is he's going to give me victory. Your whole army's going to have to run after this. Why? It's because I live a life that's set apart. I live a life of a worshiper because I know how to pull praise out of me when it's a dark season. I know how to pull worship out of me when maybe things don't seem too good right now. Right? These are men of God. Paul and Silas, David, Jeremiah, all these great men of God that knew how to worship. Sometimes we may be going through some battles, but worship is how you fight your battles. Come on now. I know sometimes what we like to do is, hey, we go through a battle, and we like to run to a person, and we don't run to God. I'm not saying it's bad, but what I'm saying is run to God first. Hey, get in prayer. Hey, create that atmosphere of breakthroughs inside of your living room, inside of your room, inside of wherever you're praying. Hey, if maybe you're silent, pray a little louder. Worship is how you fight your battles. And when you apply these four D's in your life, worship will bring hope and unity to people. Come on now. I can imagine in that prison cell. The prisoners were not just hearing, they were listening. They were listening. Why? It's because they lived the life that was set apart. They lived the life that was all God. It was all God. They said, hey, look, if you need me to go to church service, I'm going to be there. If you need me to be in the prayer meetings, I'm going to be there. If you need me to do this or do that, I'm going to be there. Why? It's because I'm living a life that's set apart. I'm living a life that's going to glorify you. I'm living a life that I'm going to give you all the praise. Hey, maybe my flesh wants to do a little different. Maybe this prison cell inside of me wants to keep me in chains, wants to keep me under generational curse, wants to keep me talking negative, wants to have me spreading poison. But guess what? Paul and Silas didn't have that. As a matter of fact, they praised, they worshiped. And when that happened, when their lifestyle came into the picture, a breakthrough happened, a miracle happened. Fear will have to flee when you feed your faith. Maybe there's some of you tonight, and I want to encourage everybody, if you're tuning in, it's okay. Stand up right there where you're at in your home. I want to challenge you. Stand up right there in your home, wherever you may be at. And this is one thing that God stood out to me. Is that willpower, right? Willpower. We have to be careful with willpower. Because it wasn't willpower that Paulus and Silas unlocked their praise. Will worship, right? Many can produce an outward show of success for the time. But in the cracks and in the midst of it all, their lives, the deeper inner condition would eventually be revealed. Willpower. What I feel tonight, right, is maybe there's resistance right now. And maybe this message is for tonight. There's resistance right now when you're home. Resistance right here where we're at. Resistance. But I know when there's resistance, there's great revival. One thing that I love about Paul and Silas is they were celebrating in a dark place. They were celebrating because they knew how good their God was. They knew how good he was. No matter how ugly it got, they didn't believe. They knew that there was a breakthrough. As a matter of fact, what they were saying is, look, you can put me in a prison cell. You can chain me up. You can put wood on my feet so I won't escape. But guess what? I'm going to unlock some praise inside of me. There may be great resistance right now, but I know with my God, there's a great revival. I know with my God, there's revival happening. I know with my God, he's going to open up that prison door. Why? It's because I lived a life that was devoted to him. Why? Because I live a life that was sold out to him. As a matter of fact, I'm a shout. And when I shout, and when I scream, and when I worship, people are going to listen. People are going to come under, and they're going to listen. As a matter of fact, these doors, this generational curse that's been holding my family for a long time, it's going to break. Why? It's because there's a worship inside of me that I'm not going to shut down, that I'm not going to silence. As a matter of fact, I see the rest of these prisoners, they're quiet because they don't know God. But for me and Silas, hey, we know who you are, God. As a matter of fact, we're going to shout and we're going to let loose this worship. And what'd you see? A breakthrough came. When the walls around Jericho came, what happened? They marched around them 7 times. But when they blew the trumpet, the walls came down. Behind worship, I'm going to share a little bit with you. Behind worship, it's not just a song. Not to a disciple, not to a Christian. It's not just a song. It's a war cry. It's a war cry. When I think of worship, I see angels marching, fighting the war for us. When I think about worship, I see freedom happening. When I think about worship, I see demons fleeing. When I think about worship, I see chains being broken, families being restored, drug addicts becoming men of God. When I think of worship, I see war happening. I see God winning. If you notice, when David was singing to Saul, when he worshiped, the demons fled. So right there in your home, and maybe you're not even in the mood, I want to challenge you to worship God because he deserves it. To worship God because he needs it. To worship God. I want to encourage you right now in this time. When those prison doors opened, he was delivering a healing. Does the enemy hear your voice? Can the enemy hear your voice? Can the enemy feel the impact of your life? Don't be silent. Don't shrink back. Maybe you can find yourself in a prison cell. Don't shrink back. And this is another thing. Is when you don't worship, is what you're doing, honestly, is you're worshiping that prison cell. Hey, if I can be real, when we're doing this, we're worshiping our problem. We're worshiping that situation. Hey, Paul and Silas, they were different. They were saying, hey, I'm not in the mood, but guess what? I'm a praise and I'm a worship. I'm a lift up my hands. Maybe I've been beaten. Maybe I've been thrown in prison and in the courts. They didn't approve of me. But guess what? I'm a lift up my hands because I'm not going to worship my problem. I'm not going to worship this situation that I'm in because I know that right now you're going to do a miracle. Maybe a miracle inside of your family. Maybe a miracle inside of your marriage. Maybe a miracle inside of your spiritual life. They didn't shrink back. They didn't keep their hands down. They lifted up their hands and they worshiped him. They were giving praise to God and not to their problem. No, for us, we're not going to worship our problem. So what we're going to do is we're going to lift up our hands. No matter how ugly it gets. No matter how hard the devil's knocking on your door. No matter how it may feel like there's not a breakthrough coming. There is. You've seen it with Paul and Silas. There is. There's a breakthrough coming. So I'm going to lift up my hands. When I think about God and worship, it gives me no other choice but to move around. To jump, to shout, to let the world know that I love you, God. That I'm a do this till the wheels fall off, God. That I'm all yours, Lord. That I'm going to take this time serious and not joke about it. When the walls broke down from Jericho, I can imagine the type of celebration that they got. They had that mindset. Hey, I'm gonna take back what's mine. I'm gonna take back what's mine. These walls are broken down. And when I think about walls being broken down, I hear generational curses disappearing. I hear healing happening. When you see the worship team, that's a miracle that's being brought forward to you. When you hear their voices, that's a miracle that's being delivered to you. You don't even have to find yourself in church. And there's a miracle being delivered to you inside of your home. It gives me no other choice but to worship God. It gives me no other choice but to lift up my hands. It gives me no other choice but to give my whole life to Him. So right there in your home, wherever you may find yourself, I want to encourage some people to step out of that same routine and worship God. While they sing the worship song, maybe you're not in the mood. Maybe you feel great resistance. But imagine the pain and the hurt and the discouragement that Paul and Silas felt. There was a breakthrough that happened. There's a breakthrough that wants to happen right now. So while the worship team sings, let it out. Something right now. It may feel like maybe it's not happening. It may feel like, no, it's not happening. It is. You know what the most beautiful worship is? It's when it's found in a place of darkness, but your voice bringing light forward. When your voice and your life is still bringing an impact of God. Where, hey, the most powerful worship is when it comes from a cry. When you feel like ministry had you. When you feel like, hey, my family's not catching it. The people I'm working with is not catching it. hey, everything that I'm doing, God, I'm living it all for you, but it seems like it's not working. Hey, I find myself in a dark place. It feels like everybody's coming against me. I feel like quitting. I feel like giving up. I feel like these walls are closing in on me. That's the most powerful worship that there is, because it's coming from a heart that's full of anguish, that's full of tears, that's full of screaming out, God, I need you. That's what these men were doing. And I'm being a little intentional with this, because there's a great resistance right now happening. And I'm pretty sure you feel it in your home. But there's a breakthrough coming. There's a breakthrough coming. There's a revival hitting right now. And I believe, and I'm crazy enough to believe it, and I want you to know this with me. God's healing someone right now. Behind this worship, God's delivering someone right now. No matter how ugly it may feel or how ugly it may seem right now, God's doing something right now. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, God. And I just pray, Lord. I know, God, that you're healing someone right now, God. And we're going to be able to hear of that miracle and that testimony, God. I know behind worship, Lord, you're doing something great, God. So I place right now into your hands, God. I ask right now, Lord, that you will move, God. In the name of Jesus, Lord. In the name of Jesus, God. Remove the distractions, Lord. Let it be your spirit that grips onto the life right now, God. Squeeze on tight, Lord, and do not let go, God. Let there be a praise that's unlocked inside of us, that no matter how ugly it gets, that we will worship you and we will praise you, God. In the name of Jesus, God. Right there in your home, what I want you to do is I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Maybe you want to recommit your life to God, or maybe you may be tuning in and don't know God, but you want to secure a spot with Jesus. Repeat this prayer after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you as a sinner, and I believe you died on the cross for me and rose on the third day, and I confess you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, come into my life and make me a worshiper. In the name of Jesus, amen. If you did that prayer, believe me, you just put a smile on God's face. What's up? Come on now. We just want to welcome you back out. We want to invite you. Excuse me. We want to invite you tomorrow to our regional service. It will be taking place in San Bernardino. But what we're doing is we're having it online. It's going to be the Inland Empire, the Coachella Valley, and the High Desert. We're all going to come together. And we know that God's going to move in a special way. So connect with your leaders. Connect with us, with the team, and we can get you plugged into the service that it's going to be taking place right there at 7 p.m. You don't want to miss out. And also, you can kind of see it as a blessing. Come on now, because not just tomorrow we're having a regional, but also next week on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, we're going to be having a High Desert region. That's two different events. So be ready. Be ready to spiritually eat. Come on now. Be ready to cause a revival inside of your homes and wherever you may be tuning in from. But with that being said, you don't want to miss out. Next gang night will be Friday night at 7 p.m. And encourage people to tune in. Encourage people. Bring them into your living room. Bring them wherever you're watching from. You know, share it. Share it with people. Also, follow our Instagram page, VO_Barstow_gang. We have specials. We have raps, spoken words, devotions, different things that we just want to show to the world and show to the people. So if you're not following us yet, follow us. And with that being said, we just pray and we hope that you're blessed. Amen. God bless.